Bismillah, alhamdulillah, salatu wassalamu ala rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man istanna bi sunnatihi wa ba'd. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. This smile is because I'm not alone, and you're with the honorable guest Mawlana Zakariyya Harnekar and Mawlana Saalim Peck. Is it still Mawlana? Mawlana Zakariyya?
Mawlana.
I only even remember my name being Zakariyya, but...
Is it still Mawlana Saalim?
Mawlana. Is it still what now?
Is it still Mawlana Saalim? Titles
as
change.
As opposed to?
Titles change.
I actually asked about it once. I was told, no, you will forever be Hafid Mawlana. You can go do whatever you want to do.
Well,
but you're not going to get a doctor.
I've since become Sheikh.
Okay, mashallah.
Oh, mashallah.
So now is that the upgrade or
the
downgrade?
I only changed from master to mister. And,
here's a question for you. What's the difference between a Mawlana and a Sheikh?
Depends how quite you dress, man. I'm just joking. It's obviously from...
I'm asking you. What's the difference between a Mawlana and a Sheikh?
Well, I guess it's because of where people graduate from, geographics.
But we all graduated from the same place.
So we graduated from Cape Town, South Africa. Yeah. From Strand, actually.
If you want to get him to call you Sheikh instead of Mawlana, you might just get one guy who wants to call you Sheikh in front of other guys. Then they can hear that oh, say Sheikh. Then everybody else will start saying Sheikh.
In fact, you don't have to be
a Sheikh or Mawlana. You might just get someone to call you a title.
No, but seriously, what is the difference between a Sheikh and a Mawlana?
I think historically, Mawlana's, if you studied in the Arab regions, you would be a Sheikh.
No.
And if you studied in the Indo-Pak subcontinent, you'll be a Mawlana.
Is that always true?
Is it region and type of institute?
Not always true. In Egypt, for example, like certain big mashayikh, they called him Mawlana. Mm.
No, there's a lot of other factors. Like I was joking, but on international platforms, then generally they don't use Mawlana that frequently. So they just give you the title Sheikh. Yeah. But what has happened as a result, I get people like literally asking me, like I had a nikah the other day, and before the nikah, they phoned me to ask me like, is it true you're a sheikh now? And I was like, how do you answer that question? Like for me, I'm a nobody, but then they say that.
You're saying that one day, I don't know how I was dressed that day, but somebody came to me and told me, but you actually look like a sheikh, man.
Yeah.
So I said, what does that mean? Like, anyway.
Allah bless all our scholars.
Amen. So I got the guys back together again because, mashallah, we're in a new space, a new studio. And I thought, what better way to launch the studio than to get the crew back together? It's a very difficult crew to get together. In fact, if I were to tell you what time we're recording this, you would understand how difficult it is.
But we're supposed to be going live now, but Mawlana Irshaad is, I don't know, you must have all the things permanent proper.
Live after Isha, no?
Exactly. Imagine if I had to put a notice out, look, we're going live, and then who's stressing? I'm the only one sitting here stressing.
If you say after Isha, and we're coming from a dhikr in Buka,
right?
That's just going raucous.
MashaAllah.
I can expect it to be...
You mean that in a positive way?
Yeah, when I say rokas, I mean it's like spiritually rokas, yeah, mashallah.
No, alhamdulillah. So, we are... it's the end of 2023. It's now the 28th of December, subhanAllah. The year has flown by. So let us just look at what's currently happening in the world. And our tarteeb in this group is usually that we connect everything with the Quran, with the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as we know, our minds, our hearts are still with our Palestinian brothers and sisters and all of the oppressed people around the world. We stand with them. And I ask the brothers, let us explore a very relevant surah in the Quran that deals with many of the atrocities that we witness and that we are feeling in our hearts. So I'll ask Sheikh Saalim, Qari Saalim, to... render us those ayat min fadlikum of Surah Al-Buruj.
You can actually even, just before we start, you can actually even call him Khabawlana now since he's
Allah.
Cool about that life.
Allah.
Anyways, bismillah.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. A'udhu billahi minash shaytanir rajim. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والسماء ذات البروج واليوم الموعود محمود وشاهد ومشهود قتل أصحاب الأخدود النار ذات الوقود إذ هم عليها قعود وهم على ما يفعلون بالمؤمنين شهود وما نقموا منهم إلا أن يؤمنوا بالله العزيز الحميد الذي له ملك السماوات والأرض والله على كل شيء شهيد إن الذين فتنوا المؤمنين والمؤمنات ثم لم يتوبوا فلهم عذاب جهنم ولهم عذاب الحريق إن الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات لهم جنات تجري من تحتها الأنهار ذلك الفوز الكبير إن بطش ربك لشديد إنه هو يبدئ ويعيد وهو الغفور الودود ذو العرش المجيد فعال لما يريد هل أتاك حديث الجنود فرعون وثمود بل الذين كفروا في تكذيب والله من ورائهم محيط بل هو قرآن مجيد في لوح محفوظ صدق الله العظيم
ما شاء الله تقبل الله الله يكسبت
نعمكم
It's an ajeeb surah in how it speaks about so many of the aspects of what we're witnessing in Gaza since the 7th of October. The surah is called Sura Al-Buruj. It's a Makki surah, and it speaks to the theme of Tadhkir bi ayyamillah, reminders of the days of Allah predominantly, which is a theme that Shah Waliullah rahimahullah ta'ala, he identifies as being one wherein we are supposed to look at history and take lesson therefrom and identify the characters and apply that in our lives. Basically, فَعْتَبِرُوا يَا أُولِي الْأَبْصَارِ Take note, O people of intellect. This is why you have divine history. So, Naam, let's just talk through it and basically derive the lessons therefrom. I'll start, inshallah, with the first verse. بِسْمِ اللَّهِ الرَّحْمَنِ وَالسَّمَاءِ ذَاتِ الْبُرُوجِ By the sky and how possessive it is of constellations. It's filled with stars, with constellations of stars. And of course, different mufassirun, depending on who you read, will go into this to different extents. But when I read this ayah, I don't think of the literal stars. I'm actually thinking about how ironic it is that, you know, further on in the surah, it's speaking about destruction. And today, when they destroy Gaza, it comes in the form of rockets in the sky, and you like visualize these rockets that look like stars in the sky when it starts, but then turns into destruction. But that's not tafsir, that's just my own, you know, what I think about when I hear the ayah. Dhatil Buruj. It's a typical opening for a Makki surah. Allah takes aqsam, oaths, wassama'i dhatil buruj. Many surah open like that, and generally when it opens like that, it is a short, powerful series of verses that tends to make a point at the end. So that's the opening verse.
I think one of the, just, you know, thinking about the description that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses, we know this concept of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taking oaths at the beginning of surah that comprise of various parts. So you have the particle in Arabic, like the wa, that's indicating that you're having an oath being taken. And then you have the thing by which, or the things by which Allah takes the oath, and then you have like the thing for which Allah took the oath. And it's always like interesting to see the relationship between them, because I think in, well, I don't think in like Quranic exegesis principles of tafsir, we learn that there's always a relationship between the thing that by which Allah took the oath and the thing for which Allah took the oath. So we're going to go on further into the surah and we can perhaps touch on that. But just as a first thought on the what Allah is taking an oath by here is, Allah is taking an oath, was-sama'i, by the skies, or by the sky, that il-buruj, it possesses, as you mentioned, constellations. But buruj, firstly the sky, and then the stars, or the not just the stars, but the constellation of stars in the skies, they create this image of loftiness, of majesty, of like a greatness that is beyond what you comprehend.
Because like otherworldliness.
Otherworldliness. But just also, you know, when you look at the sky, you look up and you see a star, and the star looks very small, but you know that the star isn't small. In fact, you know that the star is huge. So when you see a constellation, huge constellations of stars, which is what Buruj indicates to, not just small groups of stars or clusters of stars, no, huge constellation of stars, then it's like your mind becomes bedazzled by greatness.
Allah.
And Allah takes the oath by the sky that possesses these stars, and you recognize, as will be later emphasized in the surah as well, that all of these, the sky and these constellations, that we can't fathom the greatness of, they're all creations of Allah that belong to
Allahu
Him.
Akbar. Look at the connection. You mentioned connection, Mawla Zakariya. But the very next verse, the second thing that Allah then swears by is, وَالْيَوْمِ الْمَوْعُودِ, by the promised day, the day of Qiyamah, something that you can't at all see.
Yes.
Allahu Akbar. Look at the beautiful opposite connection. Huh? You look up at the stars, you know, like this is something that exists in front of your own eyes. You can really perceive it, but it's created by Allah. And the day that you had been promised, there's no indication to you that there is a day like that. You can't see it. You can only but imagine what it's going to be like.
You know,
but the same Allah creates that thing that you can't ever yet see until that day that you're going to be there seeing it.
I know we agreed that this is going to be somewhat short form. And inshallah, we'll keep it like that. But you know, there's something... There's another set of verses that, you know, threw my mind to that point that you're making. You know, in Surah Mulk, a slightly more staggered, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the fact that He adorned the skies.
Zayyana as-sama'
ad-dunya bimasabih. So you can see that. Right? You can see that, and you can see the beauty of it. And then what does Allah say? وَجَعَلْنَهَا رُجُومًا لِلشَّيَاطِينِ. So there's like part of it that you can see. You can see the... You know, sometimes if it is related to that physical phenomenon, you can see the shooting star. But you can't witness its purpose because it's rujuma li shayateen, which are unseen.
No.
And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala goes into what after that? Zayyana as-sama' ad-dunya bimasabiha wa ja'alnaha rujuma li shayateen wa a'tadna lahum adhab as-sa'ir, which you can't perceive at all. But just like you don't, you know, doubt the one that you can see, you shouldn't doubt the last.
Allah.
MashaAllah. MashaAllah. Wal yawmi al-maw'ood.
The promised day.
You know, again, there's tafsir, and this is a very important thing. There's tafsir, which is generally going to be restricted to either what the Quran says about itself, what the Sunnah says about it, what the Sahaba said about it, and even what the Tabi'een said about it.
What's derived from the language.
And it comes, or it's derived from the language or logic and the like. And then there's ta'wil, what is generally referred to as ta'wil, even though there's differences in terms of that word, it's also referred to as isharat, where it's things that Allah just kind of opens up to people when they read the verses or when they think about it. The first thing that comes to my mind when I read it, the tafsir is clear, this is the day of judgment, it's the promised day. There are some other views also that you can refer to this, you can refer to that, but I just think of like the day that Masjid al-Aqsa is finally liberated and the Palestinians are finally freed, because it's a promised day. Like the day of Qiyamah is a promised day, but the liberation of Al-Quds is a promised day. And I just really can't wait for that day. Like, yeah, I want to be on the first plane to Palestine, to a free Aqsa, and celebrate with the people of Palestine. So, okay, that's again ta'wil.
I would even wish to be there before, you know, to help with getting it free, subhanAllah.
No, I mean, yeah, but look, yeah. I agree with you, but I first want to make sure I do everything in my power to help them here. I don't think I'm doing enough, you know what I mean?
Yeah, subhanAllah.
But na'am, so wal yawmi al-ma'ud, the next verse, wa shahidi wa mashhud.
You know, just on what Mawlana's saying there, I think it's very important for people. You know, obviously you respect the tafsir as a first layer of meaning of the Quran, and right, and tafsir that comes from the language and, you know, things that have been commented on. But it's very important to read the Quran introspectively.
Yeah. With your own set of eyes and your own experience of what life that Allah granted you so far.
Because that's how it guides you. You find guidance for it in that, it for your situation.
So that is actually the whole process of tafakkur.
No.
And tadabbur, you know, reading and pondering on Quran, which can also only happen if you read like other parts of the Quran, because that keeps your mind, it keeps you related, and you know, you tend to not stray away if you've read numerous and multiple parts of the Quran. If you read only one sticky and you think about that, it's very easy to, you know, you think about something that could be or could be relevant, but then
come up with random
stuff. You just come up with random stuff, man. But if you've read through the Quran once or twice or three times and you know like the general content, and you then ponder, subhanAllah, Allah just guides you like to connect meanings and verses and understandings to one another.
And you must also learn, you know, like, of course, make the fakur, but learn. Don't I'm a mufassir now, that type of thing. You must know the difference between the two.
Wasn't this program called Tadabur or something?
Tafakkur. And so that's why we spoke about this point quite frequently, and it's important because people mustn't get the impression that, look, there's a bunch of guys just deciding, you know what I mean? We know the difference between tafsir and what's not tafsir. But wal yawmi al-ma'ud wa shahidin wa mashhud. Like here, for example, this is tafsir. Yeah. So in the tafsir, they explain that this refers to the day of Jumu'ah and the day of Arafah.
No.
It's one of the most predominant opinions as to what this refers to. Now that I've mentioned that, you can also see a correlation between the fact that Allah calls it a shahid and a mashhud because of the nature of the days. But then in the same surah, Allah also references the fact that wallahu ala kulli shay'in shahid, that Allah is a witness over everything.
Wahum ala ma yaf'aluna bil mu'minina shuhud. So there's like a repetition of this.
Yes. So that whole concept of shahada,
mashhud, shuhud, shahid, and the fact that they're being killed because of the shuhada.
So that's a common thread in the surah, which is important because here's the thing, man. One of the feelings that we have all been, I mean, I'm speaking for myself here, but many people have related the same to me. There's a sense of, Ya Allah, like, when is Allah's help coming? Like, how much more suffering can these people take, right?
Don't think Allah's not away.
There we go. Don't for a second get the impression that Allah is unaware of what's taking place. When in such a surah that's practically themed around the oppression and genocide of a people, which we'll get to, the thematic, or rather the themed term or etymological root that you find in there is shahida. Shahida yashadu, which means to witness. And it's constantly referring to the different components, but all coming back to the same three root letters, shahida, because Allah is witness. Naam?
Ya Rabb.
So what comes next?
قتل أصحاب الأخدود النار ذات الوقود.
Right, so here's a story, a bit of a story, yeah?
So this is actually...
This is a big story.
So if we had والسماء ذات البروج واليوم الموعود وشاهد ومشهود, those were the three things by which, or the three verses in which Allah mentions the قسم.
The جواب القسم, right?
Or the مقسم به, the things by which Allah took the oath. And now we're going to get into the thing for which Allah took the oath, the muqsam alayhi, or upon which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took the oath. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says what? Qutila ashabul ukhdud an-nari dhatil waqood idhum alayha qu'ud wa hum ala ma yaf'aluna bil mu'minina shuhud. So Mawlana, I think you want to introduce that. Are we going to get into all of the different?
It's a very long discussion. I actually just wanted to get through the whole surah so that we can, you know, have an understanding of the way Allah deals with the situation. I would imagine that this is a good point at which we can say, read the story, because it's a beautiful story. The story of Ashab al-Ukhdud, and there's some ikhtilaf as to which exactly, you know, which incident exactly it refers to.
Where can people read it?
I would say Ma'arif al-Quran is a good English resource. Tafsir ibn Kathir is another good English resource.
It is the same too. I was going to.
Okay. Because in English, that's you're not very, you know, you're not spoiled for choice, really.
There's another very simple one.
Mm-hmm.
It's like more like a translation with notes folded in. I think the story might be mentioned in there, but I'm not sure.
Quran Beheld. Sheikh Nuh.
I was thinking of Quran Made Easy.
Oh, yeah. Mufti Afsan Hussein Ilyas.
Something like that.
Hmm. It's a good book. Yes. It's a good book. He combines there in Jalalain and a couple of other tafasir. But be that as it may, the reason why I don't want to focus too much on the story, because the story in and of itself is amazing, is the way Allah deals with what took place there. So you have Ashab al-Ukhdud, these people, they are an oppressed people and they are being killed. They're being massacred, like literally massacred. And the way they are being massacred is brutal. It's a brutal massacre. Ukhdud is referring to like trenches that have been dug for them. And An-Nari Dhatil Waqood is a reference to the fire. Nar. Dhatil Waqood, that is like a huge fire, because it's filled with fuel. So it gives you an impression of how huge this fire is. And they're being burned alive, basically.
So trenches of fire.
Naam.
People sitting around these trenches of fire, the tyrannical disbelievers, basically, sitting around these trenches of fires of fire, oppressing a people simply on account of the fact that they believe in Allah, and they're oppressing them by throwing them into these trenches with fires built.
Yeah. So you just included a number of verses there now. إِذْ هُمْ عَلَيْهَا قُعُودٌ.
They're watching over them.
We can touch on each of those separately. They were witness as well to what they were doing with the believers. And then the next one, وَمَا نَقَمُوا مِنْهُمْ. They only did so.
But before you get there, so they're sitting around these trenches watching what they are doing.
Yes.
So they're like spectating on the whole punishment, the genocide that's taking place as well. Which is, it kind of emphasizes, look, on the one hand, there's them committing a horrific act. Okay, but then there's them celebrating the seraphic act.
Spectating and
enjoying it, you know. I don't know if you guys have seen, but there's literally videos of Israeli sitting watching the bombing of Gaza, or in their buildings, in their apartment buildings, and then they hear the bombs and then people applaud and they cheer.
Yeah.
This is what is being described here, right? And then النَّارِ ذَاتِ الْوَقُودِ إِذْ هُمْ عَلَيْهَا قُعُودٌ وَهُمْ عَلَى مَا يَفْعَلُونَ بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ شُهُودٌ.
Whilst they were, so they were sitting around this fire whilst they were watching and beholding what they were doing to the believing people. So Allah again uses the word shuhud. They are witnesses to what they were doing themselves to the believing people.
SubhanAllah. Allah mentioning that He is the witness, but also mentioning that those committing the atrocity are witness as well to the atrocity that they are doing.
And I think in that, we're going to get to that verse now, which I think we'll touch on there, but in that there's like a very interesting and profound, psychological fortification that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala presents to us. And I think it's very pertinent to us in this time. And people can actually get trauma on account of watching what's happening in Gaza.
No.
You know, people with clean hearts, pure hearts, I mean, perhaps even people with sick hearts can, you know, get trauma on account of it. But generally, I think people who are sympathetic will feel more affected. And
it's both ways. It's both ways. Because they that are witness, that are committing, they are becoming completely desensitized.
Not just desensitized, Mullah. Deranged. I just watched something yesterday. I think it was either Al Jazeera, one of the websites. One of the Israeli soldiers. He woke up like in a deranged fashion, probably because of trauma that he was undergoing, experiencing. We don't really feel sorry for him. He's partaking in a genocide, right? But he woke up deranged and he shot at he shot basically a whole lot of Israeli soldiers. Because of, his mind went into that state. So, But I was more focusing on the fact that, you know, people, POT people, sympathetic people, they see what's happening, and it can cause trauma, can cause anxiety, can cause a feeling of difficulty in your heart. And especially on account of the fact that when you have a group of people watching over, it shows that there's a dominance. They've already cowed you into submission, or they've already seemingly assumed the upper hand. And then the fact that they're rejoicing at your punishment is like a double punishment.
Mm.
And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala after that says, He describes them as witnessing the worldly punishment that they're doing here. But then He also describes Himself as being witness over what they do.
No.
And you know, to the believer's heart is always focused on Allah. How is my heart with Allah? Because Allah is looking at my heart. If my heart is good with Allah, then everything's good. And you know what? Whatever suffering I'm undergoing, as long as Allah sees it, I know that He will be just. Not just. I know that He will be merciful and benevolent.
No.
So, you know, in that, like, people look at the Palestinians and hear them talking about sabr when their family's killed. And, you know, it's from verses like these that the believers get that mindset. Yes, they're looking at us and laughing now, but Allah is witness to what they do.
No.
And nothing escapes His gaze.
I spoke to one of the resistance leaders, political leaders. We met them together.
Yes.
But then I managed to interview them in Johannesburg. At the conference now. So, I mean, you were there in the gathering. One of the things that they said was that, look, they derive the himma, the sumud, as they call it. Sumud is a term that is unique to Palestinian resistance. It means resistance, it means strength, it means sabr. There's so much. You must look it up. It's an interesting term. I gave a khutbah on it actually last week. So they were saying that in Gaza, men live for three reasons and three reasons only.
Ya Rab.
Jihad.
Jihad. Quran, jihad, okay. And Jannah.
Okay. Yeah, you mentioned different to me. You mentioned jihad, istishhad, and Jannah.
Yeah, but in that gathering, he said specifically Quran, and then he went on to elaborate. He said that before the 7th of October, they had like 1,350 hufad, of the top hufad, reading, each one of them reading an entire khatam from Fajr till Maghrib, no breaks.
Allah.
That was the way they launched the 7th of October. You see, they're so passionate about the Quran, and
we read 17 khatams
that day. Yeah.
You know, felt so good. They read 1,350, and he actually said that they had planned another gathering wherein they would have read 1,450 khatams only with the Mujahideen of Qassam.
Yes, salam.
In other words,
and you know, I mean, look here, this guy. MashaAllah, he's a machine in the Quran. Huh? But you know what it takes to read a khatam from Fajr till Maghrib. And you must remember, it's winter there now.
No.
That takes a lot of consistent building up recitation.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
Wa alaikum salam wa
rahmatullah wa barakatuh.
How's it, brother?
Is that you, Ahmad?
Small screen there.
MashaAllah. Welcome, welcome.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullah
wa barakatuh.
كيف الحال؟ شيخ أحمد.
You're ready. This is let me just introduce you. This is Pang Ahmed. He's joining us from. MashaAllah, he's joining us from Mecca. Yeah, he's joining us from Mecca. MashaAllah.
I don't think his connection is so like
a. عمره مقبول and مبرورة. Let's hear what he has to say.
Hafid Ahmed, I think you need to go buy some ether.
Oh, is that the proper? Designation.
Hafid Ahmad.
Hafid Ahmad, mashallah.
I think he needs to go buy some airtime. Okay, anyways, let's just carry on until he settles in again, inshallah ta'ala. So, yeah, subhanallah. Where were we? They're standing around and watching the believers, and they taunting them. I mean, look at the sick stuff that they do. They destroy toy shops and they make fun of the Ghazans, riding around in children's bicycles and stuff like that. They're writing the names of Muslim influences on their missiles and the like. Like, they do this. you know, something that really made me angry, like they make me sick over and over. But what really angered me, it infuriated me, was when they used verses of the Quran and threw down pamphlets from the sky, misquoting an ayah from Surah Ankabut, as if to say, like, the flood, it speaks about Tufan. Yeah. The flood is like the cause of what's happening, because they're the Dhali moon type of thing. I was just like so furious. And they posted on social media about, you know, Tayran Ababil. And then they've got an image of the missiles dropping on Gaza and it exploding. So, like, you know, I mean, this type of, you're now toying with Allah's words, man. You're toying with Allah's creation, and now you're toying with Allah's kalam. There's a new boundary that you've created, and you've gone over it again and again. But so this is what they do, and they think that it's fun and entertainment. But all the while, Allah reminds us, Wallahu ala kulli shay'in shaheed. Allah is witness over everything. وَهُمْ عَلَى مَا يَفْعَلُونَ بِالْمُؤْمِنُونَ شُهُودِ يَسْ. But, you know, again, that Allah emphatic point that Allah is a witness over them. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ فَتَنُوا الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. And that obviously takes us into the next verses. Those who, مَلْنَا سَالِمْ بَعْشَ the ayah for us in front of you. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ فَتَنُوا الْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتِ
ثُمَّ لَمْ يَتُوبُوا فَلَهُمْ عَذَابُ جَهَنَّمْ وَلَهُمْ عَذَابُ الْحَرِيقِ.
Allah.
Those who put to test the believing males and the believing females, put to test in terms of the iman, the idea of the greater increased amount of deliberate difficulty put in front of people who want to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is something that is a heinous crime in the sight of Allah.
Did we say the other verse?
Which one? Did we pass that verse?
I think we skipped that verse.
وَمَا نَقَمُوا مِنْهُمْ إِلَّا يُؤْمِنُوا بِاللَّهِ الْعَزِيزِ الْحَمِيدِ. They do not take revenge from them, except that they believe in Allah, the Most Mighty, the Most Praised. Why are they doing what they are doing? Because the Palestinians are non-Jew. It's not about because they are Muslim in this case, specifically. It's that they are not Jewish. This is the whole idea of أَنَا خَيْرُ مِنْهُ. I'm better than he. So the whole state of Israel is founded upon the idea of the superiority of the Jew over the non-Jew, regardless of anything else, really. They have a white supremacist thing going on as well, but it's primarily Jew versus non-Jew. If you're Jewish,
Jew and Gentile,
you can go to Israel tomorrow and get citizenship tomorrow. People who've been, you know, thrown out of their homes, they have no right. So that's the only reason. Yeah. Like, they've got no other reason to kill them except this.
I think we must just maybe clarify there that not all Jews are Zionists. In fact, there's many anti-Zionist Jews.
No, but this is the Zionist position. Yes, so it's not that the Jews are problematic. No, not at all.
The Zionists are problematic.
The Zionists have this thing that, no, this is a Jewish state or a state for Jews, which is insane, like in this day and age.
But I think also, Manana, one of the stated... the clearest stated objective of or reason for the launch of Tufan al-Aqsa, the Aqsa flood, which took place on the 7th of October.
As-salamu and thereafter. One second.
Like this, the clearest stated objective, according to those people who were the architects of Tufan al-Aqsa, they said it was on account of the aggression and the abuse and the denigration of Masjid al-Aqsa.
No.
So that's been
and
happening
the Zionist project
ongoingly.
From its beginning, right, they could have chosen many pieces of land in the world, but they chose Palestine. And very likely on account of the fact that Jerusalem is in there, the Aqsa compound is in there, a narrative can be created around it. And the Muslims that are living there, they could easily go off into other places.
No.
Like, they literally squashed into, like, probably, I think they are the densest population in the world. There were 2.3 million people in that small Gaza Strip. And now they are further squeezed in because the north of Gaza has been, like, demolished.
No.
They could easily go elsewhere. They could go to the Sinai. They could go elsewhere. But why do they fight? You cannot denigrate our third haram. The place from which Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam made Isra. And so it really is connected. Their struggle is connected to their faith. And so, you know, there is a relationship. They did not take retribution on them, punish them, except on account of the fact that they believed in Allah. That's what happened with Ashab al-Ukhdud. And similarly with our brethren in the world today. They are fighting for rights given to them by Allah. They are fighting for sacred spaces that were conquered by our Khulafa al-Rashidun. They are fighting for the sacredness of places that was declared sacred by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And so it's deeply connected to their faith.
And they're fighting for their homes and they're fighting for their land, which is a legitimate fight. I mean, that's why the permission was given to the believers in the first place to fight. It was because they were expelled from their homes and they were expelled from their lands. Mm. That's why the permission for Badr came. So that's completely legitimate. That is a legitimate jihad, hands down.
Of course.
And then, you know, on top of it, it's not any homes, it's not any land, it's sacred land. It's Alladhi barakna hawlahu. So, okay, look, I think everybody understands that. I think all of our audience at least would understand it's a legitimate fight. But we move on. The ayah, repeat the ayah again, fadlikum.
I just go on,
that we're busy with.
Inna alladhina fatanu.
Now, just before that.
وَمَا نَقَمُوا مِنْهُمْ إِلَّا أَنْ يُؤْمِنُوا بِاللَّهِ الْعَزِيزِ الْحَمِيدِ.
Al-Aziz al-Hamid. So whenever Allah mentions an ayah and then ends off an ayah in a certain way, there's always hikmah in the way the ayah ends and what was mentioned. So Allah is Al-Aziz, which is the mighty, is the authority. And Hamid is the one full of praise. So I specifically mention that he's the authority, the ultimate authority. Because in battles such as this, I believe it's easy to start thinking, you know, who's in charge? Who's running the show? And
but the Mujahideen are giving those guys hiding.
Hiding in a half. Allah strengthen them and give them accurate accuracy. And then Hamid is praised. So, you know, you continue to praise him. Whether you fight the believers with you, don't fight, Allah remains praised. Inna alladhina fatanu. Mawlana Saalim was giving us a meaning of that.
First, alladhina mulku
samawati. Didn't I do that? Okay, you do it.
So the next verse is alladhi lahu mulku samawati wal ard. Right? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after taking a qasam by the sama and mentioning all of these things and saying that the only reason that they are shown this retribution is on account of the fact that they believe in Allah, the one who is almighty and the one who is all deserving of praise. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, he further asserts, Alladhi lahu mulku samawati wal ard, that he, Allah, is the one to whom the heavens and the earth belong to. Right? They all belong to him. People do things with his belonging and they do with it what he allows them to do. But in reality, it all belongs to him. And eventually he will assert that will be manifest to everybody. And they will not get away with how they abused his belongings.
No. Inna alladhina fatanu.
Now we get to the verse.
You know, why? This has never occurred to me before until Mawlana Saalim was explaining it. And then I realized, look here, we are actually going to the secondary meaning of that word. When the primary meaning in this case actually works. Because the word fitna means to burn.
Yeah.
And that's literally something. What they're doing. And it means to ya salam. And look at it. What is fitna? It is that type of burning that you do to a precious metal to get rid of the bad, so to speak. To purify something. And that's what ethnic cleansing is about. That's at least from the Israeli perspective, but from the perspective of the believers, this specifically, you know, the Palestinian struggle that represents a bigger struggle of the believers in this world, it's separating. It's really separating who's who in the zoo. Like, it's so manifestly clear, like there's a haq and there's a batil, there's a good and there's an evil. And this is bringing it out more than like anything. The 7th of October happened. Atrocity after atrocity after atrocity. And I'm not judging anybody with regards to what they did and didn't do. It's between you and between Allah. But I found it highly problematic that you would broadcast something like, for example, your celebration of a Rugby World Cup final, but that same person is not posting about Palestine. I get that some people were watching it and enjoying themselves, and I don't have too much of a problem with it. It wasn't for me. But the others who were like posting about it and the celebrations and stuff like that, but you can't post a single Palestine thing. So again, I can't judge you. You maybe have your reasons. It's between you and between Allah. I'm just saying how it looked from my perspective. That's kind of that's a shame. Like, take a moment, say something, do something. If all you can do is post, as if that's an insignificant thing. But if all you can do is post and you refuse to do even that. So it just made me feel a bit not so good. You know, that people would turn a blind eye even then. And Allah knows best. But inna ladina fatanu. Like, there's a profound lesson in the fact that Allah could have used so many other words for this particular, action of these. But He used inna ladina fatanu. Fatanul mu'minina wal mu'minat. Those who put the believing males and the believing females, they burn them, they put them through test. Thumma lam yatubu, and they have no remorse about it whatsoever. In fact, they're proud of it. They justify it. They are the Amalek. They are human animals. They don't matter. They have no remorse whatsoever. Like, they literally are celebrating the dhulm. لَمْ يَتُوبُوا فَلَهُمْ عَذَابُ جَهَنَّمَ وَلَهُمْ عَذَابُ الْحَرِيقِ. And on that note of Jahannam and Azab and so forth, Assalamu alaikum, Hafidh Ahmed.
Why should bring him in on that note?
Because he's going to tell us about the Azab and how did you understand it? I didn't math.
How does he know more about it than you?
Ajib.
Alhamdulillah.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. How are you guys doing?
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
Ahmad, good to see you, mashallah.
You missed my early introduction of you, man. Did you hear it?
Is it? I'm glad I missed it because I don't know what you were saying about me.
I
can't trust what you were saying about me.
Okay, but Mullah Irshaad clarified it already, so I have to tell you off air later, inshallah.
Look, but you came in now. We can't now still get into how you and Kaifa Haluk. Firstly, Umrah Makbula, and shukran for making dua for us by the Kaaba. May Allah accept.
Ameen.
Ameen.
Ameen, Ya Rab.
And may Allah grant you the tawfiq to make many more du'as for us by the Kaaba.
Ameen, Ameen, Ya Rab, Ameen.
But seriously, I wanted you to come in on that note, man. Inna alladhina fatanu al-mu'minina wal-mu'minat thumma lam yatubu falahum azabu jahannam walahum azabu al-hariq. I want to ask you a question, right? Did you ever come across people who felt they seemingly had some reservations about the fact that Jahannam is khalidina fiha abada? It's like, how can you have that? How has your perspective developed about Jahannam over the last 2 months, 2.5 months since the 7th of October?
Yeah, subhanAllah. It's a very interesting question, to be quite honest. I don't know if you remember, Mullah Irshaad, like your seeker, maybe 13, 14 years ago, I think, we had a program. I was just in second year, or I think I just finished second year at Darul Na'im. And then we had a program. And one of the topics in the program was, what's so bad about Jahannam?
No.
And we asked you to present it.
No. Right?
And, you presented Jahannam that day. And, this concept of adab and punishment. And it's interesting you're asking over the last couple of months. But over the last few days, I was just exploring this concept of visualizing a future state, right? And how powerful that is in terms of adjustment and action, and it's making adjustments to our actions and so on and so forth. And, just thinking, you're asking obviously in light of the Palestinian issue and those who are committing these atrocities and so on and so forth.
No.
In one end, it obviously gives, it brings some sort of contentment to, some degree of contentment to us as believers to know that they're not getting away with it, even if they're going to continue for another 2.5 months or for another year, or for another 75 years.
No.
They're not actually getting away with it. And we know that, when people are going to be, when someone is just to be dipped into Jannah for a moment, it's as if they never went through any hardships. And if someone is just to be dipped into Jahannam for a moment, it's as if there was never any you know, reason for them to smile before any happiness that they've ever experienced.
No.
And you know, it sort of brings some sort of a contentment, number one, in light of all of the current issues, knowing that something like Jahannam is there and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about it throughout the Quran. So, but particularly this concept of understanding a future state is something that I was unpacking recently. And, you know, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chooses to very vividly, clearly explain some scenes in Jahannam, particularly, you know, to like a very clear graphic degree, man.
Mm.
And you think to yourself, in the final revelation to mankind, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chooses to put this type of graphic explanation of punishment and adab and so on and so forth. And it's because they, you know, some people are really going to need to, you know, imagine themselves in that space, in that future state. No. You think, Yo, subhanAllah, imagine that is me, you know. And if you can't imagine yourself in a bad future state, you're not necessarily going to make any adjustments now.
No.
And, you know, I think that is one of the biggest things that really stood out for me, because people committing these type of things who think they, you know, who act like they're the Fir'auns of our time and so on and so forth, you know, they may or may not take heed of any of this. Mm. But for us, understanding that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says and tells and teaches us, see how they're carrying on, see the kibr they're showing, see how they're laughing about it, are they proud about it, are they celebrating it, but this is going to be, you know, that outcome. Mm. And I think it's just more importantly for us to look at, you know, how we can take lesson from it necessarily. And I think predominantly it gives us a moment of some degree of contentment.
No.
To know that even though, and I don't know, I was contemplating now, must I mention some of these verses or mustn't mention some of these verses, but you know, to think what they're going to go through as a result of what they are doing if they continue and if they don't change their ways.
Yeah, well, look, the verse itself also is quite descriptive, right? The verse itself tells us that وَلَهُمْ عَذَابُ الْحَرِيقِ. They were burning the believers, and then Allah emphasizes the fact that, look, Shaykh had to burn. And,
you know,
I've never wished Jahannam upon anyone, but yo, I look forward to the day I see these people burn in hell forever.
And you see, that's going to happen. The people of Jannah will be able to see the people in Jannah. And the people in Jannah is going to call out to the people in Jannah. And they're going to say, you know, give us of that. And, you know, share with us what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you. You know, as the verse is going out, Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Muhammad.
And Saalim is falling asleep here already.
And Saalim is falling asleep. You can't give me the verse now.
Afidu alayna
min al-mai. They're saying, Afidu alayna min al-mai, oh, mimma razaqumullah. Where they're asking, you know, give us some and this, that, and the other. But the verse I was thinking about when you were talking about Adhab in light of these tyrants of the earth, and they're smiling about what they're doing now, right? And they're celebrating what they're doing now. Talfahu wujuhahum al-nar. That is the verse that is coming to mind. You know, and this imagery is as if it's hectic, but, you know, it says that their faces will be melted in the fire. Mm. And as a result of their faces that have melted, now if you see a face without meat over it and skin, then the wideness of the skull would resemble as if they're smiling.
Yes,
I know. But it's as a result of their faces being burnt off.
Yes, I know.
تَلْفَحُ وُجُوهَهُمْ النَّارُ وَهُمْ فِيهَا كَالِحُونَ.
Yes, I know.
And, you know, I'm thinking about When they, you know, how trapped our believers feel and how trapped these people feel in Gaza, and when they are under this oppression, that in Jahannam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they're going to try to run from the center of the fire, and they're going to run to the outskirts, and the malaikas are going to say, it's going to be commanded to them, خُذُوهُ فَاعْتِلُوهُ إِلَى السَّوَاءِ الْجَحِيمِ, that, you know, grab them and drag them back to the center of the fire. And if you think that you have a fire burning, then at its core, at its center is which the artist. And, you know, in Jahannam, they're going to be looking for any sort of refuge. Not to say that there's going to be refuge there, but their logic, all it's going to tell them is that they need to run And then they're going to be dragged back to the center. ثُمَّ صُبُّوا فَوْقَ رَأْسِهِ مِنْ عَذَابٍ حَمِيمٍ And pour the heads of this boiling substance that of this عذاب of حميم that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says. And then after that, ذُقْ Taste. Now get a taste. And this is just only a taste. It's still going to happen. خَالِدِين So ذُقْ إنك أنت العزيز الكريم.
Because
in this dunya, you are most al-aziz, you are al-kareem, you are most now, you are almighty. You know, you kept yourself as the almighty on this dunya, untouchable, no one can do anything.
No.
So, you know, that's what came to mind.
Tamam. Allah bless you, Sayyidi. I see, mashallah, your layers of turban is growing. Mashallah, your beard is also looking very, in a certain way, and your ring is nice and outstanding. Getting there.
Can we call him Hazrat already?
not yet. But we must wait until that. You get a couple of more layers on the right hand side there of the turban, right? We miss you. Have a good umrah.
I think I must get me a green coffee, maybe.
A green? No, man. Nah.
Sorry, man.
Come on, man.
Gone.
Okay, so we're going to wrap up on this. This is half of the surah, like literally half of the surah. We're going to wrap up on this and we can go through the rest again. I know that some of our brothers
I'll just add something on there. I'm busy falling asleep.
We used to go till like I don't know what time.
But yeah, I'm a slot for touchman. You can't hate me on the first. You can't hate me on the first session.
Kettlebells will give you energy.
Give you energy in the morning. At night time, you must go recover. You must go sleep. Thumma lam yatubu. Besides the punishment, and you know, yes, Allah will give them punishment, man. But Allah still shows us the extent of His mercy, man. ثُمَّ لَمْ يَتُوبُوا ثُمَّ of course for ta'aqib the after so they first did فَتَنُوا الْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتِ then ثُمَّ the after يَتُوبُوا if they had turned back to Allah if only they had turned back to Allah and for all of those that have turned back to Allah that have turned back to fairness and to justice we applaud you and may Allah Ta'ala strengthen you that you might be
That's
of
a beautiful
the, of
point.
Of the biggest though, yeah. voices of the truth and the haqman. Nah.
And
Those
look
that
how.
Came back and had seen.
Look at the work they're doing.
Subhanallah, like, may Allah strengthen
sure,
them all.
They're doing fantastic work. People who were pro-Zionist and become anti-Zionist are some of the biggest advocates for Palestine that I've witnessed. Nah. And show me one who the believers tell, like, no, you used to support Israel, we don't support you anymore. Mm. They've all been welcomed. No, even the hostages, like when the hostages come back and they're all friendly, then we like celebrate, hostages, you know what I mean? But subhanAllah, the idea of we don't want people to be in dalala. We don't want people to burn in Jahannam. We want the truth to prevail regardless of where that may come from. So that's a beautiful point, mashallah.
No.
I wasn't sleeping.
Allah bless you.
Inshallah, we end up on that. I can't promise that we'll be able to get everybody back together again in the next couple of months, but I'm going to try.
See, when you don't try too hard,
nah.
and you accept the conditions in which it comes, then it all works.
You're saying the conditions that it comes. Look here, you're saying the conditions with which it comes, but like that's if it comes at all.
I think maybe we must change the format, man. Have like a once a month sleepover, and then once a month we just sit all night and record for the next 2 months the recordings, and
Achmat,
you can just play
when
it a piece
back?
At a time.
Nah, the listeners are supposed to stay awake with us. Now we get a recording that they can listen at a convenient time.
Achmat, when do you get back?
The 8th, inshallah.
Mashallah.
8th of January, inshallah.
So there you have it.
January, Allah bless. In other news, Maaf.
Getting married?
It's in the middle of the holiday. May Allah Ta'ala bless and may Allah accept. Ameen.
What?
It's in the middle of the holidays. But there are some huffar that are gearing up already in terms of preparation for month of Ramadan. That is just over 70 odd days away. Allah Ta'ala grant us all to see the month of Ramadan. And we connected because this group came together because of Quran, Alhamdulillah. So starting tomorrow night, actually the Friday the 29th, at the Stegman Road Masjid, where I... I'm fortunate enough to do some khidmah, alhamdulillah, every Friday evening from 7 o'clock until...
It's going to be Eid tomorrow night, though.
Okay, bismillah. Okay.
So
everybody that's watching this tomorrow night, please make dua that all hufaz and non-hufaz and everybody that has a concern for the haqq connect themselves more to the Quran. The memorizers of Quran will be doing an extra reading effort and initiative over the next 10 weeks, inshallah. Please join us on any Friday that you are able to from 7 p.m. until Aisha, where we will revise three ajza of the glorious Quran in terms of the recitation, inshallah.
Can I just make one point?
Yes, you can. Yeah. But I also just remembered now that I received a voice note and I promised that I would address it in the next podcast. So now I'm going to play the voice note and then you're going to have to address it because...
Okay, can I just make my point first?
You can, of course.
Okay. The one thing I just wanted to mention was, I think many people will know, and I'm saying this on a podcast because there might be people with expertise and contacts that we don't have. But because of the actions of the Yemenis in the Red Sea, some ships will likely be rerouted via the Cape. And the same Hamas leader that Mullah Irshaad mentioned earlier, he had actually mentioned to us that one of the actions that they really appreciated and greatly benefited them, I think it was either in 2012 or 2014, was when the union workers in South Africa refused to
offload a ship,
and refuel Israeli ships or ships that were in any way going to help them in the operation that was taking place at that time. So if there are any people with contacts in the ports and stuff like that, if there's any traffic being rerouted, that will be harmful to the Muslim cause and to our Palestinian brothers, I make a plea to you to, you know, use your contacts wisely, use your
absolutely.
Resources in a beneficial way, and ensure that those ships are not availed of your services or the services that you can, you know, halt them from. And inshallah, that will be a great service to our brethren in Gaza. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept.
Amen.
I actually don't think I'll be able to do this. It's far too complex, man. But I'm going to play it. We can't answer it now. It's too loaded. Okay. It needs to get more attention.
Don't play it.
No, but the thing is, if I play it and I come next time and listen to the answer.
No, you promise the person is going to play it.
I'm at least going to play it to know that I am.
So the only reason I say don't play because.
The topic is regarding the whole thing with Israel and Palestine. Obviously, I've been posting things, and then one of my good friends is Israeli. He's quite old. He's 47. He's born and bred a Jew. We had a discussion, and he brought up the Hamas, which is obviously a group. I'm sure you know who they are. Militant organization that is funded by who, Iran, whatever the case is. But the agenda is very violent, and they kill innocent Israelis. You know, the things that they're doing is just something that you and I won't condone. Like a normal person looking at what they're doing, saying, "No, this is a bit violent." You know, killing innocent people is a different thing. If they were actually retaliating or defending attacks against our people in Gaza, you know, with the armies and stuff, taking out soldiers and that type of thing, you know, weaponized attacks, but going in and killing and raping innocent people, that is not something that we could condone. But I just wanted to get your opinion on this, because obviously you know a lot more. Do we condone Hamas and the agenda? Do we side with them? Do we support what they're doing? Or have they been approached to sort of stop what they're doing? Is there protest action, or is there any kind of, like I say, an agreement, or, you know, something put in place where they're going to stop doing what they're doing and maybe turn the agenda into a more righteous one, defending the people of Gaza instead of attacking innocent people on the other side? Because at the end of the day, you know, if it's innocent human life that they shed, it's not right. But do we support the Hamas, or are they some kind of radical Islamic fact, or who are they, and is there anything being done to sort of stop what they're doing? Because obviously this is inciting the Israelis to, you know, retaliate, and it's going to be an ongoing situation. I just want to get your viewpoint on that, you know, holistically speaking, just because obviously I'm new and I'm getting a lot of information from both sides while I'm speaking to someone that's a good friend of mine, just to get. But I wanted to know from my own point of view, what is the standing, the understanding, and the, you know, the support where that is concerned.
As tempting as that may be to respond to, it's very loaded and it requires unpacking, and you have to understand that this is from a new Muslim. So
I think we must just say one thing, misinformation.
Yeah, absolutely misinformation, but it's important that we unpack it, because this new Muslim is obviously, as you said, he's engaged with many different factions. So you need to unpack it one by one, so as to not, like, you know, just brush it aside. So we will, at least I will, inshallah. I don't know about everybody else here, but I will do my best to answer that in the next podcast. Bi-idhnillah, if all goes well, as soon as Ahmad gets back and he brings us our zamzam and our dates. Right, Ahmad?
Bismillah.
Don't buy your dates in Gatesville when you come back. No, you must buy your dates there in the Makkah.
And don't buy Israeli dates also.
Let's go get them with dates in Medina, sir. Not in Makkah.
Inshallah.
Yeah, yeah. We're going to Medina after this and then back, inshallah. Inshallah. But, Irshaad, like 2 minutes, man. Not even 2 minutes.
But you can't address that question.
No, I'm not going to address that.
Okay, further.
I'm not going to address it. When Saalim mentioned, and I know you're going to eat this tomorrow night, inshallah. When Saalim mentioned the Quran and the month of the Quran and so on and so forth.
He talks like at 1.5 times speed now. Did you notice?
Sorry.
Go for it, man. We only have a minute. Talk. Don't let him stop you again.
I'm just trying to get this message to as much students of Quran and Hufad and students of Quran everywhere, that this holiday period is a really important period for you to gauge your relationship with the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Allah.
It is a time in your life where your parents isn't telling you, go bacha, you work, you prepare, you memorize, you learn. There's no teacher calling you, come bacha. There's no one telling you to sit down. There's no structure forcing you to sit from 7 till 2 or whatever time your madrasa is every day. And, you know, this time actually is a time for you to gauge what my relationship is the Quran with the Quran. How much time am I voluntarily giving for the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Don't wait for Ramadan to be the reason why you're pushing up again, or when school starts again, to push up your level of Quran. This is an opportunity for you to show Allah, because the Quran, you can't earn the Quran. The Quran is given, and Allah says in the Quran, Allah says in the Quran itself, أورثنا الكتاب الذين اصطفنا من عبادنا. That Allah gives the book to those who He chooses. So a holiday period like this, where you have no parents telling you to bacha, or maybe your parents are telling you to bacha, but you're not in a class system, your teachers aren't calling you, there's no pressure of work that you must finish. You sit alone on your own and you just show Allah, show yourself in front of Allah that I'm making an effort because I want you to choose me for this Quran. And now is the time when you have that opportunity. In a time when your friends are going crazy, they're preparing their New Year's plans, they're doing whatever they're doing with these holidays, have a plan for your Quran. Make a plan to show Allah that this is what I want to do. This is what I love. This is what I want to earn from you. And it's not that you're gonna earn it, really. It's that you might just show Allah that you want Him to choose you by the efforts that you're making, inshallah. So if you're suckling with that juice, if you're suckling with memorizing of you, it's just that moment when Allah is going to decide to give it to you. But that's what you must work for, inshallah. So use the holidays and use it as a pure, sincere opportunity to show Allah, Allah, there's no reason that I need to be sitting now. I'm doing it for your sake. So grant me to be a part of this Quran. Grant me to make this Quran part of my life. Grant me to love this Quran.
Ameen.
Habib, please make dua for us, and please make dua for the studio and for Isnad Academy. We look forward to seeing you here. Make dua for the Ummah, Barakallah, and make dua for our brothers and sisters in Gaza especially, and all of the oppressed people around the world in general as well. Barakallahu feekum. So since you are in Makkah you're in the targhib mode, and you put us all in a fikr now, I'm ready and I'm going to go cash. So please do the honors.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمد
صلى الله عليه وسلم
أجمعين. ربنا تقبل منا إن أنت السميع العليم وتب علينا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار وادخلنا الجنة مع الأبرار يا عزيز يا غفار يا رب العالمين. اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه.
آمين.
اللهم اهدنا واهد بنا واجعلنا سببا لمن اهتدى.
آمين.
اللهم إنا نسألك الهدى والتقى والعفاف والغنى.
آمين.
اللهم زدنا ولا تنقصنا وأكرمنا ولا تهنا وأعطنا ولا تحرمنا.
آمين.
وآثرنا ولا تؤثر علينا وأرضنا وارض عنا برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين.
آمين.
اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين.
آمين.
اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين.
آمين.
اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين.
آمين.
وأذل الشرك والمشركين ودمر أعداءك أعداء الدين برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين.
آمين.
اللهم انصر إخواننا المستضعفين في غزة.
آمين.
اللهم انصر إخواننا المستضعفين في فلسطين.
آمين.
اللهم انصر إخواننا المستضعفين في كل مكان. آمين. برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين.
آمين.
اللهم استرنا فوق الأرض وتحت الأرض ويوم العرض عليك.
آمين.
اللهم استرنا فوق الأرض تحت الأرض ويوم العرض عليك، ولا تخزنا يوم العرض عليك يا رب العالمين.
آمين.
واجمعنا بنبيك ومصطفاك يا رب العالمين. اللهم اهدنا بهداك، وارزقنا بتقواك، ومتعنا برؤياك، واجمعنا بنبيك ومصطفاك برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين.
آمين.
وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد النبي الأمه وعلى آله وصحبه وبارك وسلم، وسلام على المرسلين، والحمد لله رب العالمين.
جزاكم الله خيرا. آمين رب العالمين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته.